Luke chapter 10, you pick up here. Of course, Luke chapter 9 is the first sending out of the disciples. Luke chapter 9. And Luke chapter 10 is where we pick up. It's where Jesus now is sending out the other 70 disciples out to the nation of Israel to be a witness and a testimony for him. If you read with me, please follow along. If you look at these three verses, get hold of it. It says, after these things, the Lord appointed other 70 also, and sent them two and two before his face into every city and place, whether he himself would come. Therefore said he unto them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, just take a few minutes tonight to look at your word. I ask now that you will give us understanding, clarity of mind and speech for myself. I pray now that your spirit will preach with me, for me and through me. Hide me behind the cross. And indeed, as this church indeed made this whole month of missions emphasis month, Father, we do know that missions is at the heartbeat of God. And we know, Father, that Jesus Christ himself said when he walked this earth, he came to seek and to save that which was lost. And I pray, Father, that we as believers will continue to be encouraged to take the gospel of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, to this lost and dying world. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. We look in Luke chapter 10 here. We'll pick up a few things and we'll be rolling. If you can keep up fast, I'll probably preach it real fast, so I'm going to encourage you to listen fast too also. But in Luke chapter 10, we notice here that Jesus Christ, the 70 disciples, other than the 12, to go there to be a witness. We notice we picked up in verse 2, he says, therefore said he unto them, the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. And as we look out of this world today, Christianity, we talk about missions, of the whole idea, all of us, in some sense, is a missionary. All of us ought to be taking the gospel to the lost and dying world, as we look at it. And we realize that indeed, that the labor out there to get the gospel is such a great task. And Jesus Christ telling his disciples, these 70 men, as he looked at them, he said, hey, of course the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. And we know a lot of times that we live in today, and a lot of believers are being drawn and pulled away from the task of what they ought to be doing. And our number one task and mission as believers on this earth, why Christ left us, is to get the gospel out. Not to become rich, not to become popular, not to be eased in or sucked in with the world. But Christ has left us here for the sole purpose to get the gospel out. And you know, teenagers and all, you're expected also to get the gospel out. I think about so many years, I come to the youth conference at different times, and how I was challenged and encouraged by other preachers, older than myself, Pastor Adams and others, to be a witness in high school. Mm-hmm. And some of you attend government school and you ought to be a witness. You're not allow yourself to be sucked in or to melt in such a melting pot, you would say, but to stand out for the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Jesus tells us, says, truly, the harvest is great, but the laborers are few. And he notices the requirement he gives. He says, pray therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he would send forth laborers into his harvest. When we think about the whole world, God created the world, and in essence, the way he is the great farmer. So basically, all of it belongs to him, and he wants us as laborers to go out there. When you think about that word labor, you're thinking of someone that is constantly working to accomplish the task. That's not just some lazy, slothful person. That's exactly someone that is always going for the master and the Lord Jesus Christ. When Christ walked this earth, one of the blessed thought about the fact is, he says, I have meat that you know not of. When his disciples, when they asked him, say, eat, he say, I have something to reach. What is he talking about? He says, the harvest is ripe, and look upon the field, they are ready to be reached, referring to the lost, the Samaritans at that time. But the disciples at that time were thinking about food, because they were hungry. And as believers, you know what? We need to get the message and focus to take that message to the lost. Notice for me in verse 3, it says, go your ways, behold, I send you forth as lambs among wolves. You know, as believers, the fact of the matter is, the world that we live in is against us.
You're right.
Jesus Christ says the world hates you. Mm-hmm. And as believers, we got to keep that in mind all the time. Mm-hmm. At no point in time, the world loves us as believers. Yeah. You know, the Bible tells us that the whole world lieth in wickedness. Let that soak in for a minute. The whole world is like in a pool of water floating in wickedness. That's what that verse is communicating.
everything from the world's philosophies and teaching is wicked in the sight of God. And it's against God. And when we as believers sometimes plug into that, it's we start to adopt those activities of the world. Notice with me in verse 4, he says, carry neither purse, nor scrip, nor shoes, and salute no man. By the way, verse 4 gives us an urgency, friend. An urgency to get the message out. Do not get distracted.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ told those 70 men, say, when I send you out, don't get distracted. Focus. And you know, a lot of people today are just losing their focus. I just think about in fundamentalism, in the time that I've been saved and grown up in it, it seems to be so many fundamental believers are losing their passion for souls.
Oh my.
People, they'll just spend money here and there. And you know, talking about faith missions, Pastor was mentioning earlier, boy, yardy air believers even talk about that no more.
Mm.
They talk about everything else but faith missions and getting the gospel out. You know, what wrong with a believer taking a summer, taking 1 week out of the summer, take a vacation and go on a evangelistic trip?
Yeah.
What wrong with a believer doing that?
Nothing.
Nothing wrong with that at all. You know, our people seem to be just losing an appetite for spiritual things.
Yeah.
And some of the other men, they know what I'm talking about. It seems our people are losing that appetite for spiritual things. And the appetite is gaining for worldly things. While the loss is dying. Notice with me in verse 5, he says, and into whatsoever house ye enter, first say, peace be to this house. And if the Son of Peace be there, your peace shall rest upon it. If not, it shall turn to you again. He says, as you go, peace be to you. You know, the gospel is called the gospel of peace.
Mm-hmm.
There is no peace outside the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The world can try to gain peace all they want. There's no peace in fornication, drunkenness, gambling. Not no suffering peace. Through Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. Thou will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee because he trusted in thee.
Yes,
great peace have they which love thy law, and nothing shall offend thee.
Right.
Then the peace of God which passeth all understanding shall rule your heart and mind through Christ Jesus. No peace outside of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Bible teaches. Notice verse 7, and in the same house remain eating and drinking such things as they give. For the labor is worthy of its hire, go not from house to house. You know, you realize as a believer, as you take the gospel message, there'll be some people that will reject you and refuse you. Christ says, don't waste time with those that don't want to accept the message. Go to the ones that want to receive it.
Right.
When you're witnessing to somebody, don't waste time trying to, Dr. Lewis used to say, one of the professors, he used to say this all the time. What in the world that you think, young man, can cause you to persuade somebody who's been raised and born in Jehovah's Witness faith or Islamic faith in one day to accept Christ? Very rarely. When they normally convert, it's normally over a series of study going with them. Taking day by day, showing them through the scriptures, hey, their way is wrong, and you prove it by facts, and then eventually they start to see, oh, this is right. It don't only happen in one day. But he said, be careful to not waste time on those that don't want to accept the message. Notice with me in verse 8, he says, and into whatsoever city ye enter, and they receive you, eat such things as set before you. Verse 9, and heal the sick that are therein, and say unto them, the kingdom of God is come nigh unto you. Let me say here, of course, we understand this is a different period. They had that miracle healing power. You and I don't have that as much today. We pray for people to get healed, and you know you got all kind of fakeries and clowns out there who say they can heal people, but it just isn't so, because it isn't Bible inconsistent with scriptural teaching.
You're right.
The Bible tells us to pray for those, if the water money gets, pray for those who are sick. Let them call for the elders, amen?
Amen.
Pray. Let the elders come and pray for them. And it says, the faith of the one that is sick will heal them. It has nothing to do with the person's healing them. We're in a different era, different time. They're just trying to steal people money.
Right.
You know that guy dressed up in white suit, that's right, the one they call Benny Hand, chicken, female chicken, whatever it is. But notice with me, go on verse 10. But in whatsoever city ye enter, and they receive you not, go your ways out into the streets of the same and say, in even the very dust of your city, which cleaveth on us, he say, make this statement, we do wipe off against you, notwithstanding, be sure of this, that the kingdom of God is come nigh unto you. Say, if you go and you take the message and they reject you, he say, put a curse on them.
Mm.
He say, you want it? Have it. Have your way without me and see where that can lead to you.
Mm.
You know, I've been evaluating
the news as we look at certain things in the last couple of weeks or a month. And I thought about that tragedy that happened in the United States up in Connecticut. I say to myself, I did American history and I studied American history. You know something like that never happened in the history of America? Never. And then I was thinking about this and I sat and meditating. I said, hold on. What never happened in the history of the Bahamas that I can remember? Maybe Pastor Alex might have to help me out. Yeah. Where a student with a 20-year-old will come and try to cuddle his 5-year-old by the heart to sacrifice it. It never really occurred to me that ever happened in these countries' history. But you know what happened? The people are starting to reject God. Now follow me. Guardian angels are associated with children. Each children have a guardian angel. If you reject the God who the guardian angels work for, would that mean that their guardian angels will also leave also? Because each child have a guardian angel. But if you keep kicking and rejecting the God, will they not also leave and go with their master who they serve in? You don't kick out the blessing and expect to have his blessings and his presence. That's what I say. Wonder if that happened and this country is just plundering down because people are rejecting God. Yeah. And God is slowly removing his hand of protection. And then you see the children start to suffer as a result of the adults' choices and decision to reject God. Sometimes we don't realize the dire consequences that we bring on our lives when we reject God.
That's right.
I wonder if that country was serving God wholeheartedly, would they ever have that happen? A wacko come in and kill children. It's naturally for men to want to protect little children, never to bring harm to them.
Wow.
We got to be careful when we reject God, folks, and his message and his way, what happens. Even in this country, when I thought about that, I say, my goodness, what is the Bahamas coming to? That someone would try to cut out his brother's five-year-old brother's heart. I see we must be losing the power and the presence of God in this country.
You're right.
You see, the Bible says having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof. Form don't work, friend. It don't bring the presence of God. Having a love for God more than you have a love for pleasures, keep the presence and power of God in your country and in your homes and in our lives and our churches. Notice what he goes on to tell us in verse 12. He says, but I say unto you that it shall be more tolerable in that day for Sodom than for that city. You know, the Bible tells us in the book of Psalms, all those nations that forget God shall be turned into hell.
You're right. Yeah.
Nations that forget God will be turned into hell, according to the Bible. Notice it says, but I say unto you that it shall be more tolerable in that day for Sodom. Wicked Sodom and Gomorrah will be more tolerable in that day on the judgment day than for that city that rejects God. Woe unto thee, Chorazin, he said. Woe unto thee, Bethsaida. For if the mighty works had been done in Tyre and Sidon unto Gentile nations, he says, which have been done in you, they had a great while ago repented, sitting in sackcloth and ashes. He says, I bring my message to you, the Jews, and you reject it. But if these two Gentile nations had seen all that I did, they would repent. So many times, modern-day believers miss the little miracles like that video was presented. Sometimes God works in so many ways in our lives, and we just forget God and his plan. Missions don't work without people. You realize that? Now, God can work without the people, but he chose to use what? People.
Right.
When the people get distracted and not focus on what God wants them to do, then their heart will not be connected with God's heart. So when God says to give that money for missions, and they say, no, I want to get me a new iPod, man. Keeping up with the times here. Missions. No. Lord, you leave that on my heart. You know the Holy Spirit touching your heart, but you say, no, I got this for something else.
Yeah.
I got this for something else. You say, no, put that towards mission. Put that on faith mission. Give that towards some work. But that's when our heart get out of touch with his heart. Notice verse 14. Verse 15, and thou, Capernaum, which are exalted to heaven, shall be thrust down to hell. Capernaum was a city that lodged in a place where it was close to the Sea of Galilee and so forth, but it was a more of an
upper echelon type city where a lot of more middle class and rich people live. You say you're folks that have become prideful, almost like the Bahamas, you know.
Yep.
Mm. You're right.
Indians forget where their success comes from now.
You're right.
Yeah.
Believe I can't. All this referendum garbage going on, you know. I think it was last year sometime, one of the MPs said in the parliament, well, the church don't really have no say in this matter. Is that so?
Mm.
Last time I checked, the Bible says the church is the pillar and ground of the true friend.
You're right.
The church has plenty to say in a lot of matters. Yeah. They've got God, divine authority set up on this land out of the fire.
You're right.
But they just want to kick God out of the way and just do their own thing and fulfill their lusts.
Wow.
And unfortunately, we got Christians siding and joining with them.
You're right.
For the love of money is the root of all evil.
You're right.
The love of money. That's all it is. When you turn tail and start, I said this a couple weeks ago preaching in church, in my home church, you know, it's one thing for them two brothers of the Christian Council movement to be fighting and try to stand. And I don't agree with everything that they stand. We don't agree with everything that they practice. But at least they try to stand for righteousness in that area against that gambling foolishness.
You're right.
Then you got a guy who come and hit them from side, serve, they ain't expected from out of nowhere. What? You guys are homophobic. You wasting time on gambling, you know, they can pass the law. And so you know what? There's no reason to try to go against it. What, really? That's what Christians are supposed to stand?
Mm-hmm.
People can commit fornication, but we still can say fornication is wrong and ungodly.
Yes,
people can be drunkards, but the Bible still can condemn drunkenness. Woe unto him that put strong drink on his mouth. Woe unto him that rise up early to give his neighbor strong drink. It's still against the word
of God, so we can still preach against it.
Yes, sir.
Right.
And we don't care how many people are doing it, it's still wrong because thus saith the Lord.
Amen.
Verse 16, he says, he that heareth you, heareth me, friend. And he that despiseth you, despiseth me. And he that despiseth me, despiseth him that sent me. When you reject the message of Jesus Christ, you say, hey, you're not only having a problem with the messengers, but you have a problem with me who sent the messengers.
Mm-hmm.
And when you have a problem with me, you have a problem with God the Father. You know, some people in the world, they still like to try to say, they don't. Some people, they will refuse to acknowledge that Jesus Christ is God. To reject Christ is to reject God the Father.
You're right.
Notice it says in verse 17, and the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. Wow. They come back to the Lord Jesus Christ rejoicing over the blessing that they saw. They cast out demons, all this great work that is happening. Ooh, I sure would have liked to have been there to see that, amen. Hallelujah. But you know what? They were rejoicing and excited to see the devils even subjected to them. Now notice what Christ said. And he said unto them, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Christ does interject certain statements sometimes, you know. And I studied and I think, you know, why would he interject that in there? I mean, they talk about that, the fact that the devils are subjected. I mean, Christ said, yeah, I know. I was there when I kicked Satan out of heaven when he tried to rebel against me. He done lost the battle. So you guys should be too amazed that you have that power over them. You know, sometimes as believers, you know, sometimes you hear believers say, well, we can't do it no more. Well, I don't know if I could get rid of this sinful habit. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world.
Yeah.
Wow. Sometimes as Christians, we operate as like, man, Jesus Christ is dead or something.
Yeah.
You ever notice the average Christian, they may be living? And you know, one preacher said it, and this is so true, the average Christian prayer can be answered by some millennial. The average Christian prayer request can be answered by some billionaire. By Bill Gates or someone like that. Or one of those rich sheiks that live out in Lifeherty that comes down and a couple of times over the year and say Lifeherty. Oil sheiks. You know why? Because most of our prayer isn't at the impossible level. We're not praying for our country to be revived and people to be reached and people to get saved again and the people in this nation have to be turned back to God and away from being falling after the lust of their flesh, that lust of money and that covetous nature that they had. And that's what gambling is putting on their covetous nature.
You're right.
No more people want to talk about Jesus anymore.
Yeah.
Verse 19, he said, behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions. Of course, that is a specific
instruction was to that 70. You will try to be able to step on a scorpion and a snake. See which one right will do these. Snake, like the fire out of you, drop down there. The Bible said I had power, but no, that was to them particular 70.
Yes,
right?
And
the early apostles. Notice it goes on to tell us, it says, and over all the power of the enemy. But you and I, we do have power over the enemy. But we have power through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And nothing shall by any means hurt you. Now, of course, they had a specific protection and command. And, of course, their 70 also do reflect, in a way, the 144,000 virgin young men that will be in the future that will go out and do a massive evangelism during the tribulation period. Of course, they will be protected. They will have the seal of God. These men are also protected. But the Bible tells us for our time that we live in as believers, and they and all they that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution.
Amen.
Most of the Christians in the world actually face persecution. Us in the Western world, we're sort of protected by certain laws that we're beginning to lose. But most of the other Christians in certain part of the Eastern world and so forth, they face persecution for their faith.
Mm-hmm.
But notice it goes on in verse 20. He says, notwithstanding, Jesus says this. Hey, in this rejoice not. Don't rejoice that you have power over the demonic powers and you have power over Satan. But notice what he says in verse 20. That the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice over this, because your names are written.
Yeah, that's
heaven. Hallelujah.
Yeah. Amen.
You're saved and you're on your way to heaven.
That's right.
Hallelujah. Don't look so glum, John. I know some of you are tired. You say, oh, by the long day, the long night, you wish to be done. Now, guess what? Rejoice in the fact that you know Jesus Christ is your Lord and personal Savior. And all
Amen.
Rejoice in that you know Christ. You know where you were once? You was on your way to hell.
That's right.
I was on my way to hell.
Sure,
you was lost and undone without God and His Son.
Yeah.
But now you've been saved and redeemed. You've been called a joint heir of Christ.
Right.
No more do you have to look to this mess in the world.
Right.
You can look to heaven and you can rejoice and say like the prophet of old in the Bible, look into that blessed hope of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I got a better hope, my friend, beyond this world.
Yes,
I might be nothing in this world, but I am something in the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Here's the worrying about what's going on in this world. I'm going to be a witness, friend, and we continue on to be supporting missions. Because this is God's plan, this is His heart, and we ought to continue to support. But you know what I realized over the years? We won't support missions if we're distracted. We won't support missions if our heart is consumed with worldliness. Because we're too confused and distracted from the mission at hand. And the mission of God is still reaching the lost with the gospel. He called us to go. Not to stay, not to sit down. Some people call out to go in full-time missions to certain places, but all of us are called to be witnesses every time.
Amen.
In every vein and in every aspect of our lives.
Right.
And they encourage us to continue to be witnesses. And remember, as Christ gave the message to 70, He has given us to preach the gospel to every creature.
Amen.
Go ye into all the world, reaching the lost. Here's Bob's answer. I want to encourage